Well, good evening.
Good evening.
Good to see y'all this evening, and got some visitors, and Brother Gene, it's good to see you here this evening. I think if you hadn't got your hug in, get your hug in before he leaves now. But it's good to see y'all tonight. We're going to go ahead and start off and praise the Lord in song. So if you open up at 469, we'll sing the first, second, and last verse. Revive us again. Please stand with us.
We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again.
In a second. Pleasure this evening to introduce our guest, Brother Jody Nasworthy. He's the music director at Cedar Street Baptist there in Metter, and that was my granny's home church. So I really have a special attachment for Cedar Street, and my mama grew up and had aunts and uncles at that church. So and if you've never visited that church before, I'd encourage you, if you told me that you skipped Sunday here one time to drive to Metter and visited Cedar Street, it would be well worth the drive just to visit sometime. It's a great, great fellowship of believers, and their love of Jesus just shines through in everything they do. They love the Lord there. But I am going to turn it over to Brother Jody, and he's going to share with us, and just sit back and enjoy and worship. Brother Jody.
Thank you, brother. How are you? That was... Those were some kind words. You don't hear that much from a pastor coming from his pulpit. Hey, you skip Sunday here and go to Cedar Street. But we are fortunate. We're without a pastor at this time, so just remember us in your prayers. We're in that transition, that awkward transition stage. And my youth pastor from the church was supposed to be here tonight speaking for you, but he's off training. For his new job, so I told him, I said, that's fine, I'm still going, so I'm here with you tonight. And it's so hard to pick three songs to sing for a church. I can do an hour concert, no problem, but to find three songs that is going to touch each and every person in here, that's the hardest thing to do. But I think I did a pretty good job tonight, so it's good to see some of you golden agers, good to see some of you youth, good to see the rest of you, and what did I say, something funny? I didn't say old people, I said golden agers, or more mature adults. We have them in our church, and it's just always a pleasure to see you faithful believers here. So the first song I'm going to sing tonight is For You.
Yeah.
contemporary. It's one of the newer ones on the radio. It's called Overwhelmed.
I see the work of your hands, galaxies spinning in a heavenly dance. Oh God, all that you are, so overwhelming. And I hear the sound of your voice, all at once it's a gentle and thundering noise. Oh God, all that you are is so overwhelming. I delight myself in you, captivated by your beauty. I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I run into your arms, unashamed because of mercy. I'm overwhelmed by you. I know the power of your cross, forgiven. You are the most beautiful.
And this last one is the one that Brother Vic asked me to do.
there stands an endless mercy tree. Every broken, weary soul, find your rest and be made whole. Stripes of blood that stain its frame, shed to wash away our shame. From the scars, pure love released, salvation died.
Understand why. That's powerful, isn't it?
Yes.
Powerful. You know, last night, Brother Walter encouraged us. He asked us, will you be revived? I mean, we're having a revival. We've turned aside this week to come together, and something inside of us needs to be stirred. You know, it's like Brother Walter said, you have to have something that was there in order to revive it to begin with. From those smoldering ashes, it seems to have died away sometimes. And it's like he said, there's probably never been a time in this country when we need revival more.
Amen.
But there's something there. Revival really is for the church. And anybody's welcome. And if you don't know Jesus, I encourage you to know him now, not later. But this is a time for us to stir something up and get it going and get those flames going that were there before. And he encourages them, will you be revived? And maybe you're thinking to yourself, I want to be revived. I don't know where to start. You know, Michael Joe Paul sang Sunday. And when he was up here, you know, he was talking about how, you know, how he had the privileges of growing up in the church. He had the privileges of his parents and grandparents and, you know, being godly folks and being in church. But not everybody has that opportunity. Not everybody grew up in the church. And maybe that's you. Maybe you're sitting out there and say, I don't know where to start. I want to love Jesus. I want to be stirred up for him. Where do I start? Well, I hope I can help you a little bit with that tonight. My question for you tonight is, are you walking worthy? And you might say, worthy of what? Worthy of our Lord, worthy of our God, worthy of the heritage of the saints who have come before you. We talked about homecoming here Sunday, and I showed a slideshow of the heritage that was here long before I got here, of the saints that were here before that built this church, built this beautiful building. And Lord, I saw the building y'all were in before this building. This is nice. But we need to be worthy of our calling. We need to work as hard as we can with everything in us to be disciples that are worthy of the calling that's been put on us. So my question to you tonight is, are you walking worthy of that? Are you, with everything you have, trying to walk worthy of that? So if you have your Bibles, I'm going to ask you to turn with me to 1 Thessalonians. Short little letters, the letters to the Thessalonians. Just before Timothy. So 1 Thessalonians. And I'm going to ask you to turn to chapter 2. And we're going to start reading in verse 10. We're going to go verses 10 through 12. So 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verses 10 through 12. And I'm going to give y'all the same treatment I give you on Sunday. And in reverence for God's word, I'm going to ask you to stand as we read from God's holy, perfect, sufficient, and inerrant word this evening. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verses 10 through 12. If you'd follow along with me. The Bible says, you are witnesses, and God also, how devoutly and justly and blamelessly we have behaved ourselves among you who believe. As you know, how we exhorted and comforted and charged every one of you, as a father does his own children, that you would walk worthy of God who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. Let's pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much this evening for your word. We pray that your Holy Spirit would take your word and help us to be stirred up by it, to lead us and guide us to become more like you, to become the disciples that you would have us to be. We pray this evening so diligently for revival in this church, in this community, in our nation, Lord. We pray for revival. We pray that you would send revival. We pray all these things in the precious name of Jesus. And the congregation said,
amen.
You may be seated. Now there's three things, and there's some other scripture I'm going to flip to a little bit later. So keep your Bibles handy. Three things that I can find that the Bible says that we need to walk worthy of. Number one, the Bible says that we should walk worthy of God. We should walk worthy of God. Number two, the Bible says we should walk worthy of the Lord. You say, well, that's confusing. You just said walk worthy of God. I'll explain it, I promise. Walk worthy of the Lord. And number three, walk worthy of our calling. Walk worthy of our calling. Okay? And we're going to work through each of those. The first one, worthy of God. Worthy of God. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 12, we just read, the Bible tells us that you would walk worthy of God who calls you into His own kingdom and glory. There's also a cross-reference there that I'd be remiss if I didn't mention. We need to pay attention. If you want to turn there, that's fine, but you can jot it down a little later. But in 3 John, which as you know is very short, it's only one chapter, but in verse 6 it says, if you send them forward on their journey in a manner worthy of God, you will do well. What does it mean to walk worthy of God? What the Bible is discussing here is the aspect of our Christian life that we talk about so often at First Baptist Church Ellabelle, and it's really about the lifelong pursuit of holiness, godliness. And when you pursue holiness and work to become worthy of God, you're in the lifelong act of attaining godliness. Now, does that mean being perfect? No. If any of us had the ability to be perfect, there would have been no sense in Jesus coming. But what I'm talking about this evening is pursuing godliness. Going after and attaining that mirror image of God as much as we possibly can in this life. 3 John verse 6 was talking about how if we go forward in a manner that is worthy of God, we will do well. We will succeed in serving God's kingdom if we do that. I think many would misread this to say that there are things we can do or that there's somehow a lifestyle that we can live whereby we can somehow be worthy of what God has bestowed on us. That is a fundamental misunderstanding of God's word. I tell you, listen very clearly, there is nothing we can do that can merit the things that God blesses us with. There's nothing you can do to earn it. It's not by our works, it's by faith. It's by grace that God saves us. And more importantly, there's nothing we can do to merit the salvation we find in Jesus Christ. There's nothing we can do to be worthy of that. So do draw a distinction with me. What the Bible is talking about here is that we make God as pleased with us as possible through our behavior. The Bible is saying, look, if you want to have God bless your ministry, whatever your ministry, that doesn't mean you're a preacher, necessarily. Doesn't mean you're a Sunday school teacher, necessarily. Whatever you do in life, you're a minister. You're a minister of Jesus in every aspect of your life. I don't care what you do. I don't care who you come across in your life. You're a minister, and the fact of the matter is, you're either a good minister or you're a bad minister. If you say, I'm a Christian, but you go out and you don't try to even do anything remotely close to living a godly lifestyle, you're a bad minister. And you're reflecting Jesus badly. Do you want to be guilty of that? But we're all guilty of that. So we've got to work to not do that. We've got to work to be good ministers. The people you come across with, that person you don't really like that you work with, you can be a minister to that person. You can be a minister to the people on your Facebook. You can be a minister to the people in your family that aren't living for Jesus. Oh, that's hard sometimes, isn't it? It's probably harder to witness to family members than it is to friends sometimes, isn't it? Because they just kind of brush you off a lot of times. But they can see. Here's the key. A person can see whether or not you've made a life change and it's real. How many times have you seen somebody come down the aisle and they were all teary-eyed and it was just this wonderful experience? They say, I've changed it. Then they leave and they're right back doing the same things a few days later. I filled in at a church for a friend not that terribly long ago. This young man came down the aisle at the end of church. I didn't even notice him. And then the pastor's wife nudged me. She said, you can pray with him. I said, okay. So I went over. I asked him, I said, can I pray with you? He said, please do. And I did. We prayed. I shared with him. I said, you need to get a good Bible-believing church with people who love you. And I said, the church we were at is a perfect, perfect example of that. I said, you need to come back. And you need to just delve into God's Word. That's where, because of the problems he was having, I'm telling you. I said, you need Jesus more than anything else right now. You need the people of God around you. You know what he did? The next night he went out drinking with a bunch of friends. He's just completely, it's like nothing happened. But you see, people can look at stuff like that and say, Jesus didn't make a difference there. It's not that Jesus didn't want to make a difference there. It's that his heart was closed to it, I believe. He wasn't ready to make a change. He's being a bad witness. He went from, it's all about God, it's all about Jesus, to it's all about me. It's all about what I want. You see, when you say that you're a Christian, you're saying that God has saved you, Jesus has made a difference in your life, and when people look at you and they don't see that difference, you've been a bad witness for Christ. And that happens all too often. But if you want God to bless your ministry, your job, your family, all those things in a real way, if you want His presence in your life in a real way, we Baptists, we don't talk about that too much, do we? How many of you want God's presence in your life in a real way? In a real way. Not just sitting on a shelf getting dusty. You want Him in your life in a real way. Amen. I want Him in my life in a real way. Amen. A real way. I don't want it to be superficial knowledge. How many of you know that knowledge doesn't equal Christianity? It's not just about what you know, it's about what you do. It's a relationship. If you've ever been married, if you've ever been in any sort of relationship, you can't just know your partner, can you? No, it's work. A relationship is work you put into it. And I think a lot of people find that the more they put into it, the more they get out of it. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing with a relationship with God. You want Him in a real way, my friends, you have to live for Him. The Bible says we must abide in His Word. We must seek Him. We must pray. Spend time diligently learning who God is. You can't do that by lukewarmly, haphazardly worshiping Him once in a while where it doesn't mean anything. You do that through being completely sold out for Him. Everything about you screams Jesus. You know, we often talk about it like this, like it's a list. And I think there's something to that, where it's God, family, friends, and me, and so forth. There's something to that. I'm not discounting that. But I saw a good one in one of my seminary class readings the other night. It was a circle. Right smack dab in the middle of that circle is Jesus. See, it's not so much a list as it is everything centers on Jesus. Because if Jesus is at the center, you got your marriage up here. Your marriage is going to fall into place if everything's focused on Jesus. That's just how it works. If you're more in love with Jesus than you are your wife or your husband, you're going to love them the right way. And vice versa. Your kids come off of that too. You learn to love Jesus right. You learn to love your kids the way Jesus loves you. Your folks at work, your ministry stuff, your church stuff. See, it all focuses around the center, which really is Jesus. We have to be completely sold out for Him. Everything centers on Him. We do that through studying His Word diligently. You know, and I said this Sunday, but it bears repeating. There's a lot of things I wish I could have seen Jesus do. I wish I could have seen Jesus walking on that water. You know what I mean? I wish I could have seen Him feed those over 5,000 people with just a little bit of bread and a few fish. I wish I could see those things. But I'm really more lucky than those people because I have God's word and I can have the whole picture. Those people didn't get it. They didn't get it. Even his followers. He says, I'm going to tear down this temple and rebuild it in 3 days. What are you talking about? It took thousands of years to build what's behind you. Jesus, what are you talking about? They didn't get it. He was talking about him. You see, they didn't get it. We've got his word. We can look back. How do you get to know God? How do you get to know Jesus? By reading his word. And not just, let me see how much I can read it one time. No. You've got to study it. You've got to know what it meant to the people it was originally written for. Then you take it, you pray to the Holy Spirit, God, please teach me something with this. How many of you pray to God to teach you before you read his word?
Amen.
Is that not important? Mm-hmm. Baptists, we got to, I guess you can't talk about a Baptist unless you are one, and I are one. So, but we don't like to talk about the Holy Spirit a lot. But we can't know anything apart from the Holy Spirit's teaching.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit is the teacher. When you sit down with God's Word, don't do, all right, here I am, I'm going to start reading. No. Pause. Say, God, I need you to teach me. I need your Holy Spirit to teach me right now. I'm giving you my teachable heart. Put my biases aside. Put my opinions aside. Put my hatred aside. Whatever's in my heart, put it aside. I need you to go through this and I need you to teach me. I need your Holy Spirit to move. Pray for that. Then read it. Then study it. Read what others have said about it. Goodness gracious. We don't know everything. And then meditate on it. Sit there a few minutes. Ponder it. Think deeply about God's Word. Seek Him in prayer. Like Brother Gerald said last night, wait for an answer. Give God an opportunity to answer. You see, being worthy of God really means that you have made a deliberate decision to make God pleased with you through your study, through your actions, through the way you treat others, through the way you handle your money. Are you being a good steward of what God has given you? That sort of thing. Pleasing God. Nothing ought to bring you more pleasure than putting a smile on His face. That should be the thing that pleases you the most. How many of you know that walking close with God leads to you feeling Him in a real way in your life? Amen. I don't mean just knowing He's there. I don't mean just saying you believe in Him. Goodness gracious, if anybody believes in God, it's Satan. Don't you know that Satan knows God's there?
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Some people think, well, I just believe in Him. I know He's there. That's all it takes, right? No. I mean, you really feel Him. And you really begin to see His hand move in your life and in the lives of those around you because you seek Him. And I'm here to tell you this evening that you can't seek Him, you can't know Him apart from Jesus Christ because you can't even pray. You have no access to God apart from Jesus. You know that? He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father. Not just being saved. You have no access to the Father but by Jesus. I've seen in my own life so many times when God has been in control and He's moved. Maybe you've had those moments. And in those moments when I'm really seeking Him and I'm really focusing on trying to be holy and righteous and being godly and those things that I know He wants me to be, that's when I can reflect back over my life and see how He's worked. Yo, I've told you this before, but we've got some visitors, so I will repeat it. I'm not perfect. And we all know that. My wife will tell you, if you do not believe me, I am not perfect. I don't have it all together. And if you read God's Word, I love that God's Word is full of people who don't have it together.
Amen.
You know what? These people, they're more saintly than I can ever be. But you think about the people that wrote a bunch of the Bible. Paul used to persecute Christians. You think about Moses. Moses was a murderer. They didn't have it all together. But see, Jesus can take a nobody and make him a somebody through His Son. He's the one that does the work. But I'm going to tell you, when I was at Georgia Southern, I certainly wasn't living for the Lord. Not in any way, shape, or form. I wasn't trying to be worthy of the God that I was created by. I put him on the back burner. I wasn't paying him any attention. My thinking was, and I remember having these exact thoughts, you know, I'm being an absolute heathen right now. But one of these days, I'll get it together. Because I knew he was there. I knew he wasn't pleased with how I was living. The Bible says only a fool says there is no God. I knew he was there. All these people, they're denying. You can't look around the world we live in today and deny that there's a God. I'm sorry, I don't care who you are. But I knew he was there, and I knew I was displeasing him. And I said, I'll get it together one day for the sake of having a good family and yada, yada, yada. I did all kinds of things that I shouldn't have. But it's funny how God works. He took somebody who thought like that, slapped me around a good bit in life, and put me in a pulpit that I ran away from forever. I did not want to be a preacher. Let me repeat that. I did not want to be a preacher. I didn't want to leave the music, and Joe Paul was begging me, and then God put it on my heart. I started doing those things. But the more I did those things, the more I wanted to do. The more I submitted myself to God, the more I had a passion to do things for God. It took me submitting myself and forgetting what my desires were to do that. You know, the first sermon I prepared, and I may have told you this before. I'll do like Brother John, I'll tell you again. I'm picking at you, brother. But the first sermon I prepared, I wasn't even a preacher. I was student teaching in Vidette, Sally Meadows. I had some time where I had everything ready for my unit that I was supposed to teach to a bunch of mean little fifth graders. That's why I teach high school, by the way. But I had everything done. And my teacher, she told me, she said, you got some free time, just do what you want, because I gave you this time to plan if you want to. And I just sat there. And God just worked on me. And I just started writing. I didn't know what I was doing. And when I was done, I said, well, this is a sermon. It was called Don't Stop at the Cross. It's the first sermon I ever preached for y'all when I visited. But I laid that sermon down. I never thought I'd preach it. I didn't know what I was doing. And then, through taking classes with Brother Larry at the Guidos and some other things, he called me up the day of my graduation party. At church, it had been a long day. I just wanted to go home and go to sleep. But Larry called me. I was almost to the house. And Hannah, we were going back to my mama's house. Hannah was riding with me, and Larry called me. She's looking at me funny because she knows what I'm going to say. But Larry called me. He said, I'm sick. Larry's had all kinds of ailments. But he had some kind of ailment that day. And he said, I can't preach. I'm on the list to fill in at First Baptist Matter. I said, what? He said, can you preach for me tonight? I didn't even think about it. I said, yes, sir, I will. And I hung up. Hannah said, what did you just do? I said, I told Larry I'd preach for you. You don't even have a sermon. I said, yeah, I do. When did you write a sermon? She was so mad at me. Yeah, we had a knockdown drag out about this.
Nobody told me he was going to be a preacher.
Nobody told me I was going to be a preacher, but I have written a sermon. It's on the internet. That night, I got up there and I preached that sermon. And through no planning of my own, every Sunday after that, a church called me to go preach. I never called anybody and said, hey, can I come preach for you? No, I had been on TV that night. By the way, I didn't know I was going to be on TV. That was, the man was like, oh, well, this microphone's for the sound system, and this microphone is for the television. I said, what? I'm gonna be on what? Huh? Oh, where's the door? And then the next Sunday, somebody had seen me on TV. The pastor from Portal First Baptist called me and said, will you come fill in? Then a little Methodist church called me and said, I need you to fill in. Y'all, it was every Sunday. Every Sunday, somebody called. And I said, well, God, if you ever meant to show me that you wanted me to do something, you sure did. But I ran from that. I didn't want to do that. But you know something? If I skip a Sunday, I'm antsy. I'm restless. I'm not doing what I'm supposed to be doing. I feel weird. You know, when we were in Virginia and D.C. and all that a few weeks ago, those Sundays killed me. They really did. They killed me. And then that one Sunday, we tried to go to church and they had a big rainbow flag out in front of it. And we said, no, thank you. But I'm telling you, the more you submit to God, the more you can't get enough of doing for God. And I don't care what it is. I don't care what it is. If it's your devotionals, do your devotionals for a few weeks. I don't care what your devotional is. You've got yours, I've got mine. Maybe you sit there and read your Bible or whatever your devotional is, but then skip for a day or so. You're going to have the worst day at work you can imagine. I see some head shaking because y'all told me that. Skip it. See what happens. You see, the more you submit to God, the more you feel Him in your life. And when He's absent, it's like you can feel it. Mm-hmm. You can feel it deep down inside. I'm in absolute awe when I think of how He's worked in my life. And I've heard so many of your testimonies and your stories and how He's worked in your life and how He's turned your life around, some of you. And I just think, wow, no amount of willpower on my part could turn around from some of what you folks have come from. There's nothing there in me that can do that. It's all Him. So we need to make sure we give Him all the credit on that. All the credit. And we need to be focused on trying to live for Him. Because you're going to find out, if you don't know this already, and some of you probably know this way better than I do, you're going to find out that if you're not walking worthy of God, you're not fulfilled in any way. You're not going to find that fulfillment in anything this world has to offer. I don't care what sin you throw at me and say, well, this is what makes me feel good. Well, you're not finishing the sentence. That's what makes you feel good momentarily. That's a finite thing. It's going to give you finite happiness, temporary happiness, whatever it is. The only thing that gives you eternal fulfillment are things that are eternal. And that's Jesus.
Amen.
Walk worthy of God. Number two, walk worthy of the Lord. Now you might be asking me, and I think rightly so, what's the difference between walking worthy of God and walking worthy of the Lord? When you're thinking, all right, preacher, the same thing, right? Well, absolutely. Our God Jehovah, the great I Am, the creator and ruler of heaven and earth, is also the Lord. They're one and the same. But I want you to understand that the Lord is one of God's titles. That's not His name. We simply call Him God, but the Lord is a title just like King. It's a title. And as such, walking worthy of the Lord means walking worthy of His role as Lord in your life. Turn with me, if you still have your Bibles, to Colossians 1:10. Colossians 1:10. This is the letter to the Colossians, chapter 1 and verse 10. This is part of a bigger context here, but the significance is still there. The Bible says that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing Him, being fruitful in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God. Now, I could have preached a whole sermon about that one. There's so much there. This one says that we should be worthy of the Lord. We should be worthy of His lordship over our lives. You know, in times past, the despicable practice of slavery has persisted in history. It doesn't matter if we're talking about the captivity of the nation of Israel by the Egyptians, or the captivity of many Africans early American history, or the slavery, by the way, that continues in many parts of Africa. There are places in Africa where manual labor is forced through slavery. And pardon me, but there's many parts where children are forced into slavery. And that's all I'm going to say, but it's disgusting. Despicable stuff. It's inherently evil, isn't it? To look at a person and call that person your property. It's messed up. It is. We know that. However, a few times in history, if you had a good master, even as a slave, your life could be relatively good. I mean, I want you to think about it. You say, well, nobody's life is good who's a slave. And just listen to me for a second. Hear me out. For instance, Joseph was sold into slavery, was he not, by his brothers?
Right.
Awful thing. But Joseph ends up in the cream of the crop as far as slave holdings go, doesn't he? Let me think about it. He ends up in the chief of police and security for Pharaoh's house, Potiphar. But his master, Potiphar, trusted and loved him and gave him charge over his entire house. You see, compared to the other slaves, Joseph had it pretty good, didn't he?
Yeah.
Really did. He had a good master. My message to you Sunday was this, and I want you to jump off of that. You're not born free. In this country, you've got a certain amount of freedom. Oh, yes. I'm talking about your soul. You're not born free. You're born either belonging to Satan and evil and everything that is away from God, or you belong to God through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And either way, you've got a master. And if God is not your master, I don't care if you believe in God and Satan and all that or not, you are serving the devil. You are his. You are God's enemy in that situation. But when you become a Christian, Jesus, God becomes your master. He becomes your Lord. And y'all, he's a good master.
Amen.
He's a good master. He loves you. And quite frankly, in this life, we need a master because we can't do anything on our own.
Amen.
It's like that old Southern gospel song says, I can't even walk without him holding my hand. Yeah. We need a master. You can't do it on your own. Oh, you might think yourself a loner. You might think of yourself as a loner. You might think of yourself as getting along all right. You ever heard somebody say that? I ask some people how they're doing. I'm getting along all right. But listen to me. There's a lot of folks are going to be getting along all right in hell because they don't know God. They don't know the truth. Or they do know it, but they reject it. That's the ultimate sin right there, by the way, is rejecting the gospel. Knowing it and rejecting it. They think they can do it by themselves. We have to be worthy of God's lordship over our lives. The last point that we need was that we needed to be worthy of our God and our Father, who is the ruler of all. But we also have to be worthy of having such a great master, one that loves us so much that he'd give his only son to die on a mercy tree that Brother Jody sang about. You know, the cross was a symbol of torture. It was a symbol of hatred, really. The Romans took it and they were good at torture. They were really good at it. They didn't want you to just die. There was ways to do that, you know. Chop somebody's head off, that's pretty quick, right? But hang a person on a cross and watch them bleed and suffocate to death after beating the ever-loving tar out of them. They were good at it. And that served as a reminder to anybody that stood against Rome and Caesar. They would line the roads with these crosses. You'd see people hanging there, some of them still alive as you were coming into town. Oh, I better keep it together. I don't want to wind up being that guy. But you know what we did? We took a symbol that they meant for evil, that they meant for fear, and we took it to mean something for love. Jesus turned that into the ultimate love symbol. You know what?
Amen.
Jesus took that thing. That's why we revere it today. It represents love. And we have to be worthy of such a great master, such a wonderful leader he is. There is none like him. You know, we could have easily had a bad God. I want you to think for just a minute about the pantheon of Roman gods that they had. I mean, there's no holiness there. Look at Zeus, the ultimate god, the thing that the god that's supposed to rule everything. And he was powerful according to their mythology, but he was a scoundrel. He ran around on his wife with the other goddesses and even human women. Had all kinds of kids, and I mean, but you look at the hatred and the humanity of those gods. You look at, pardon me, because I know this is so politically incorrect, but you look at Islam, and you look at their prophet Muhammad, who's at the top of their religion, and you look at, he had multiple wives. One of his wives, when he married her, was 5 years old. This is holiness? And compare all of that garbage to Jesus Christ, who lived a perfect life, who was a servant. The Master came to be a servant to die for his people so that they could be reunited with their Father. That is a love story. That is holiness. How can you put your faith in anything else this world has to offer? There's nothing there. There's nothing. Just a bunch of prayers and do this and do that. That isn't enough. None of us is good enough for that. But what Jesus offers is real. What Jesus offers is holiness. But you think about those bad gods. We could have easily had a bad God, you know. In real life, God could have been mean. God could have been hateful. I liken it to a kid. Maybe you did this when you were a kid. I did. I'm not. Take a magnifying glass outside and burn ants. That's bad, isn't it? That's bad. It's fun, but it's bad. Imagine if God was that petty. Imagine him up there in heaven and just zapping us. Praise God we don't have a God as petty as we are. You know it? Just to torture us for his own amusement. How many of you are glad that God loves us?
Amen. Amen.
I must ask you, are you walking worthy of such a Lord? The scripture we just read says there's three ways that you can do that. So my note takers, here's your three ways you walk worthy of the Lord. Number one, fully pleasing Him. That's what that scripture says. Fully pleasing Him. And if you missed one, just look back at the scripture. Number two, being fruitful in our good works. Being fruitful in our good works. And number three, increasing in our knowledge of God. Increasing in our knowledge of God. It lays it out there. Think about that first one just a moment. Fully pleasing Him. I think many times when we do things for God, we often don't put as much effort into it as we do the other compartments we have in our lives. Sometimes we like to make a little compartment for God in our life. Rather than Him being over the whole thing, He's just a little puzzle piece of it. And then I've got work over here, but I don't let God into that section. I don't want to get in trouble. I don't want to offend somebody or whatever. We compartmentalize God. And a lot of times we don't put as much effort into God when we live like that as we would into our work or whatever. And it's impossible to fully please Him when we're doing things like that. How can we possibly fully please Him if we're only putting in part of the work? If we're only giving Him part of our lives? It's impossible to fully please Him like that. We've got to put Him at the center of everything. We can't compartmentalize. He's got to be the center of the whole thing. He's the focal point of all of it. Think about that next one, being fruitful in our good works. First of all, many of us have no follow-through. We have no follow-through sometimes. We can't just start things and not finish and expect God to bless that. When we start things, we've got to see it out. We've got to, first of all, it is good to pray and make sure it is His will, right? Amen. And if He shows us, okay, this is what I want you to do, but at the first sign of disagreement and trouble, we say, never mind. You know, sometimes that's the devil, right? Sometimes the devil wants to trip us up when we're doing things for him. And the harder we work, the harder the devil works. But if it's supposed to be for God, and we do our part, God will make it come to fruition, I guarantee it, no matter what your trouble is. Yeah. Sometimes we lose focus. And as a result, because we lost focus, and the focus, by the way, is always God and Jesus and His will, but sometimes God chooses not to bless that project. You ever been there? I have. You ever seen a petty power struggle pop up in a church? Oh yeah. Sometimes it happens. And sometimes, and then we're like, well, why isn't God blessing this thing? Well, because we're not getting it together. The Bible says we're supposed to be united as the people of God. And maybe it's not getting done exactly like you want it to, but that's not a requirement. You know that? For it to always turn out exactly like you want it to turn out. Sometimes we get on an ego trip and we begin to try to glorify ourselves rather than God. We need to be careful. And that last one was increasing in our knowledge of God. Y'all, we need to be in our Bibles every single day studying diligently. Doing our devotionals, going to Bible studies, doing our discipleship stuff. That stuff's important. How else are you going to increase in your knowledge of God? That's it. That's how you do it. All those things help us to increase in our knowledge of God. And all of these things we've talked about help us walk worthy of our wonderful Lord. You can't walk worthy of somebody you don't know. You got to know His standards. You got to know His expectations. Those things are in God's Word for us to study. We study His Word in order to know Him better. And what's the last thing we should walk worthy of? And I'll be finished. Number three. Walk worthy of our calling. Walk worthy of our calling. Our last scripture, and you don't have to turn here if you don't want to this last time. It's up here if you want to read it, but you can certainly jot it down. But it's Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 1. Ephesians 4, 1. The Bible says, therefore the prisoner of the Lord beseech you to walk worthy of the calling of which you were called. You know, I preached a few months ago here about what it took to be a good church member. What it took to be effective as a member of the Bride of Christ. And I discussed with you the importance of service. Because we're pretty good at worship. A lot of people are. We're pretty good at studying. Some people, even less people are. But the service part, that's important. Finding that calling in your life and being worthy of it. We all have a calling on our lives. A calling of some kind of service. Some of us are called to be preachers. Some are called to be deacons. Some are called to be Sunday school teachers. Some are called to go out and visit and work with the elderly. Some are called to cook when somebody has had a death in the family. Things like that. Some are called to work with the poor and the destitute of this world. Some are called to go out and evangelize the world. Some are called to do these things. Some are called to work with teenagers, bless your hearts. We all have a calling. And we have to work hard to be worthy of that calling. Y'all, I've shared this with you before, but I really like this analogy. We don't have a dishwasher at our house. And I tell you, it's aggravating not having a dishwasher. And I know a lot of y'all might not have one either, might never have had one and got along just fine, but me and Hannah have been spoiled. So it happens once in a while when we get overwhelmed with school and work and things like that, that it gets awful hard to find a clean cup. Have you ever had that problem? You're like, I can't find a clean cup in this house. Now, I try to make sure that doesn't happen. We have some red Solo cups on standby. You ever been there before? Can't find a red, you can raise your hand. Nobody will think you're Pentecostal. It's okay. It happens. The question is this, can you use a dirty cup? Yeah, I suppose if you don't have another choice, but would you want to? No. Who wants to use a dirty cup? It's stained, tainted, dirty. It's unclean. Y'all, we're just like cups in a lot of ways. God can use us when we're dirty, sinning, unclean. He can. He's God, right? He can do whatever He wants to do. Many times we may have meant something for bad and we were gross, dirty, unclean, but He used it for good. Genesis 50:20, the Bible tells a story, and He says, you can read the whole story sometime if you want to, but at the end of it, it says this, "But as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring it about as it is to this day, to save many people alive." So yes, God can use us when we aren't living for Him, but here's the point. We make it a whole lot easier on Him when we're clean. When we're striving to be clean. When we're striving to live in a godly way. You see what I'm saying? When we work hard to protect our testimony and our witness, so that when we tell people that Jesus changed our life, we don't have to tell them so much as they see it in our lives. When we work hard to keep those things from being tainted, God can use us in so many more meaningful ways. Because you see, when you allow sin to dirty and taint your life, Satan begins to use you to prove to non-Christians that all Christians are really full of malarkey. If you're not willing to live for Him, Satan's more than ready and willing to use you. He uses it to drive people away from church. He has that non-Christian to look at us and say, "Well, that preacher Vic, he's a drunk, he's a liar. Why in the world should I trust him when he says Jesus is real?" See what I mean? They can look and say, "Jesus ain't changed his life." We need to work hard to make ourselves worthy of that calling. Yes, we fall. Yes, we sin more than occasionally, more than we ought to. But we work so hard to protect our testimony that those times are few and far between. So I've got to ask you something, a few questions really. Are you walking worthy? Are you walking worthy of our almighty, perfect God? The one who spoke and everything came into existence.
Amen.
Are you striving to be worthy of Him? Are you worthy of the lordship of our awesome Master in heaven? Are you walking to be worthy of that? Are you striving to make Him smile? When we walk in to His presence and He says, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant." Are you looking forward to that day? You say, "Well, maybe it's too late for me. I've done too much wrong." No. It's never too late. It's never too late. You can start right now. You can start right now. And Jesus' blood, I don't know about you, but my Jesus' blood is powerful enough to cover all your sins.
Amen.
All your sins. Not all your sins except that one. All your sins. Are you walking worthy of that one? Are you walking worthy of your calling? Of that thing that God has put on your life. And I guess a precursor to that is, are you living out your calling? You know, it doesn't do a whole lot of good if God gave you talents you refuse to use. You know that? He put them there for a reason. Praise God, Brother Jody uses his. I mean, really. You can't be pleasing the Lord if He gave you something you refuse to do anything with. And maybe you are doing it. Maybe you are. But maybe your head and your heart aren't right. You can't please Him then either. Maybe you're doing those talents and saying, "This is all me. It's all about me." No. Because you'd be nothing apart from Him. Yeah. you wouldn't have those things. I preached to you Sunday and I told you that we have God's image in us. We're like a mirror of Him, but most of the time, I told you we're like a funhouse mirror, right? It's bent. You know, God looks down at us and says, that's my image, but I don't look like that. That's my reflection, but my head isn't two-thirds of my body. You know? It's distorted, it's marred. But you see, when we seek God and we work to be more like Him, to be discipled by Him, that image is made clear. It is restored. But that will never happen without Jesus. You see, Jesus' blood covers your sins. You say, oh, preacher, but you just don't know how bad I've been. Yeah. And if you knew how bad I've been, you wouldn't be worried. You see, His blood covers all of it. His blood adopts you back into God's family. The image is restored. We're talking about being revived. If you're not working to stir what's in there, it's not going to happen. If you're not working to be worthy of what God has given you, I'm not talking about being perfect. I'm really not. I'm talking about seeking God's will. Not just in your life, seeking His will, period. I think a lot of people pray to God and say, God, I need this, 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 and this. They wanted to change His will according to their needs. It's okay to pray to God and ask Him for things. But my subsequent prayer when I pray to God is this: if it's not Your will, I don't need it. I don't want it. Because if it's not His will for your life, He's got something better. You know that? We need to pray that God reveals His will. And we need to work to be in it. Now, are we going to get perfect in this life? This lady in one of my seminary classes said, oh yes, we have the ability to get perfect in this life. Well, you think so, Miss Ma'am? The Bible says that we will be conformed into His image, but it will not be until we see Him in all His glory.
Amen.
When we see His glory, then it happens. Just like when Jesus was on the Mountain of Transfiguration, that moment, His glory, that light, it's going to change us. It's going to change every one of us. I don't think we're going to have to worry about sinning when we get to heaven, because it's going to change us so deeply and dramatically. There's nothing in us that could mess that up. We'll be conformed into His image. But my question is, why we got to wait? Why we got to wait to say, okay, I'm just going to be the regular old messed up me until that moment? No. Let's start seeking Him now. Let's get revived and start seeking Him now. Let's get stirred up for Him now. Let's start walking worthy. I don't know about you, I'm ready. You ready?
Amen.
Let's pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, I thank You so much for those that have turned aside tonight. I thank You for Brother Jody ministering to us in song this evening. I pray that You would take each heart, and if they don't know You, You just latch on to them like they've never seen before. And that they would latch right on that. And that they would just know You and be saved by Your grace. That they would just make You the very center of their life, and they just pursue You with everything they have. All their heart, soul, and mind. That they'd be willing to be discipled by You. And that they would just move ever closer, and that everyone around them would just be in awe of what You have done in their lives. That it would be real. That You would be felt in a real way in their lives. That they would seek You through Your Holy Spirit. That they would be taught by Your Holy Spirit. That they'd be most of all saved by Your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray this with all our hearts, that those that have turned it over, maybe they've just lost their fervor a little bit, but I pray that we would just stoke those flames, and that they'd be back on fire for You. And whatever's troubling them, they wouldn't walk out of here. Lord, there's no way for us to carry these burdens alone. But not for Your grace, we couldn't even walk, really and truly. Mm-hmm. I pray that whatever is on their back, that they leave it at this altar before they leave tonight. Lord, I just pray that you just hover over us now and hold us in your bosom, and that you just would never let us go. You promised that you wouldn't. You said you'd never leave nor forsake us. Draw us ever closer to you in this special invitation time. We pray all these things in his name.